Welcome everybody to the first microbiology video. This video is all about the different types of microbes that we will talk about this semester. So microbe is short for microorganism, but I want to give a word of caution. Organism is typically used to refer to living things, but two types of microbes that we're going to talk about this semester, viruses and prions, are not considered to be alive because they are not made up of cells. So please know that microbe is short for microorganism, and technically two of the eight that I'm going to mention today are not actually considered organisms, okay? But microbes are teeny tiny things that we cannot see with the naked eye. So when I do say microbe, please know that I'm referring to tiny agents that we can't see without the help of technology, like microscopes, because without technology, we wouldn't really know much at all about this invisible world around us. So let's get into the eight different types of microbes. So first up, and the type of microbe that we're going to talk the most about this semester is bacteria. Bacteria are prokaryotes. Okay, and there's going to be several videos coming up that talk about prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So for now, please know that a prokaryote is smaller and structurally more simple than a eukaryote. So prokaryotes are also unicellular, which means that the entire organism is one cell. That's it. So some bacteria are pathogens. Pathogens are disease-causing agents. So some, not all bacteria, do cause disease. So they are harmful to us. We call them pathogens. Some bacteria are very helpful to us. For instance, some bacteria make up our normal microbiota, which are the organisms that live in and on our body, and they help with things like digestion and keeping us healthy. But we'll talk more about that in another video. But the normal microbiota is good. Bacteria reproduce asexually via a process called binary fission. And that's essentially where one cell copies its DNA and kind of stretches and breaks off into two cells. So that's how they replicate. Lastly, for bacteria, there are three general categories of bacteria shapes. And that is coccus, which is circular, bacillus, which is rod-shaped, and spirillum, which is a spiral-shaped cell. And again, we're going to talk a lot more about bacteria in the coming videos. Next up are the archaea, and these are prokaryotes and therefore unicellular. But these organisms live in extreme environments, okay? Environments that are not compatible with our bodies, right? They are really, really hot, maybe really, really salty, or crazy high osmotic pressure. So the organisms that live in these conditions are not compatible with our bodies, and therefore they cannot infect us and cannot make us sick. So the archaea are not considered to be human pathogens. Next up are fungi. And the fungi are eukaryotes. Some fungi, like yeast, are unicellular, whereas other fungi, like mold, are multicellular. Most fungi are saprophytes, which is the science term for decomposers. And so their main job is to break down dead and decaying organic matter and recycle those nutrients back into the environment. The fungi do have a cell wall, which is like the wall of a cell. It gives the cell its shape and its structural integrity. And the cell wall of fungi is made up of chitin, okay, which is that word there in purple. And this always reminds me that I left out a word for bacteria. Bacteria also have a cell wall, but it is not made up of chitin. Instead, it is made up of peptidoglycan. And so we're going to talk a lot more about that when we discuss types of cells. Okay, the fourth type of microbe is algae. So algae is also eukaryotic. Some are unicellular, some are multicellular. Their cell wall is made up of cellulose, and they use photosynthesis to create their own food. So algae, you tend to find in like aquatic environments, some species are green. A lot of people think they are plants, but algae are not plants. They do not have a root structure, nor do they have leaves, okay, which are some requirements to be a plant. So algae are not plants, but they do have a lot in common with plants, like being able to do photosynthesis and having cellulose in their cell wall. All right, our fifth type of microbe, the protozoans, are eukaryotes. They are unicellular, all of them are. They do not have a cell wall, unlike the other organisms we've talked about so far. But what makes the protozoans special is that they are motile organisms, okay? But other organisms like bacteria can be motile as well, but the protozoans have really snazzy ways of moving around. So some have structures called flagella, which are those stringy things you see at the bottom of this image under number 5. And flagella move in like whip-like fashions to scoot the little organism around. But unique to the protozoans are pseudopods. And pseudopods are like little legs. So the protozoan can extend a part of itself outward to kind of test the new environment. And if the environment is good and friendly, then the entire cell kind of lurches that way. So think about like when people go to jump in a pool, what do they often do, right? They stick their toe in, they put a little bit out into that new environment and see how it is. And if it's good, they go ahead and jump in. So the pseudopod is kind of like the cell extending a toe to check out the new environment. And if it's good, the rest of the cell follows in that direction. All right, next up are helminths, which is a fancy word for worm. Now you might be saying, Chelsea, I can see a worm with my eye. And that is true. But part of the helminth life cycle is microscopic. So that's why we do include them here. So helminths are multicellular. And they are really distinguished by having attachment organs. Some have hooks, some have lip structures or suction structures that allow them to attach and hold on to their host and essentially rob them of their nutrients. And so you see this a lot, like a lot of pets get worms. Like my dog, when I first got her, she had hookworms, and they're terrifying structures. Okay, number 7, viruses. As I mentioned earlier, they are non-living. And that is because they are acellular. The prefix A means without. So viruses are not made up of cells. Therefore, they are not considered to be alive. Viruses come in all different shapes and sizes, okay, as we're going to talk about next week. But at the most simple viruses are only made up of proteins and nucleic acid, like DNA or RNA. So not cells, okay? And viruses are said to be obligate intracellular parasites because on their own, if they're just sitting out on a countertop, a virus cannot metabolize, it cannot produce or use energy, it cannot replicate and make new viruses. Okay, on its own, a virus can do nothing. It is 100% dependent on a host, a living host, to metabolize and replicate. So that's what the obligate means. It absolutely needs a host. Specifically, it has to get within the cells of the host because it essentially hijacks proteins and enzymes that the host has and uses it for its own good. And then it's a parasite because nobody has ever been excited to have a viral infection, right? Because they take over your cells and they make us very sick. Last up are prions. And prions are just rogue proteins. Okay, so within the cell, proteins are the workers of the cell. They do all the jobs. And in order to do their job, they must have a very specific shape. So prions are relatively new, okay? So they are very like mysterious. We're just now really starting to learn a lot about them. So we have way more questions than answers. But because a prion is just a rogue protein, it is considered non-living because, again, it's not made up of cells. So why do I call it a rogue protein? Well, again, proteins have a very specific shape, and that shape allows them to do their job, right? Think of it like our body structures. My hand can pick things up because the shape allows it to do so. I cannot pick up my pencil with my nose because the shape of my nose is not conducive to that. Similarly, I can't breathe through my hand, right? Because the shape does not allow that job. So structure and function go hand in hand. So every type of protein has their own unique shape, which allows them to do their own unique job. Well, for some reason, there is some unknown trigger that will cause certain proteins to change their shape. So we call them a rogue protein because they're not supposed to change their shape. And these new rogue proteins are actually able to interact with other proteins in the cell and cause them to change shape. And then again, at some unknown time, unknown trigger, all these rogue proteins, these prions, come together and they lump together and they form holes in the tissue that they belong to. And so that's what you actually see in this picture for number 8. It's a tissue that now looks like a sponge because the prions have formed all these holes in the tissue, which can be fatal. All right, y'all, that is the end of this video. Please be on the lookout for the next one.